Hi guys, I really appreciate that you are here. I know that listening to lawyers for a couple of hours is difficult, even for lawyers. So if you're here, then I'm really happy. With all due respect to my previous colleague who had presentation. Okay, so as you can see, the topic of my today's speech is gonna be about your security of startups. However, you must be aware that it's not possible to tell you everything during this time. And I want to be honest with you, just a short story. Some clients of us came to us recently with some problem, and we had to draft the lawsuit for him whole this night. In fact, we did it because we had deadline till today's morning. So the good news for the client is that we managed. The good news for all of us is that I will try to speed up as fast as possible to have the chance to get coffee before we start a lunch. What I'm gonna tell you mainly focuses in this 3 points. As you can see, those are general terms, but during my presentation I hope that it won't be so vague for you. The idea is that you can ask me questions. I hope that I will manage to give you answers for them. I think that not a bad idea is to write down the questions, and we will have the session of questions at the end, so we can discuss all the matters which are interested for you. One more anecdote. When I came here, I realized that I'm the only guy in a tie. I decided to take it off, but my dear friend Maciek from Startup Hub Poland told me that I...
You had your microphone.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I need to have it on me because I have microphone. Yeah. Yeah, sure, I know. Financial penalties. Yeah. Okay, guys, let's move on to the first thing. Non-disclosure agreements, commonly known as NDAs. One more word before I start. I will try to be as much practical as possible, so hope not to be such a boring lawyer with a tie. Feel free to ask me any questions, and I will try to focus on the practical side of the subject. So NDAs, do we really need them? Nowadays, it seems that when we get to McDonald's, Starbucks, and we want to buy coffee, they just give us NDA to sign it. When we go to our grandma's Sunday's lunch, they give us NDAs to sign it. I would say it's a trend to have it. However, as a lawyer, I strongly recommend you to sign it when you are dealing in business matters, especially with your own business, because it's for your own good to be well protected. As you can see, I put it the subjects in some order. It's the order of process of starting your vehicle, starting your startup. At the beginning you have the NDA, then you probably sign term sheet which smoothly leads you to the investment agreement. So we are here, NDA. So broadly speaking, we need it for two purposes. First one, which is important for inventors, for founders, it's protection of information. It's crucial for you because that's the asset you have. That's the main asset which you have with you. You grab it in your hand and you go from door to door and knock on it and try to find some nice people who are just waiting for you to help you. But what you have is the information, so you have to be protected. On the other hand, the NDAs are also good for the other party. It can prove, it can show that the other party received the information in the legitimate way, that there was some agreement and the parties agreed to sit to the table and discuss some things. So please bear in mind that it's useful for both sides to have the non-disclosure agreement. So very broad and general categorization of NDAs. It's the one which you can see. As the agreement, it has to have at least two parties. Okay, so that's the main idea. But there might be more parties. There are variations of non-disclosure clauses. It might be also statement of one party. But the most typical is that you have at least two parties. In unilateral NDAs, you have the obligation which is mainly put on one part of this agreement. Simply speaking, it's the situation when one party delivers some information to the other one and the other one is responsible to keep it in confidentiality. But as well, you can have the bilateral agreement. And it means that both parties give each other information. It sounds like it happens rarely, but it's not true. In most situations, when you sit to the table with investors, with VC funds, probably they will also give you some information which are important for them. The individual investors also share with you some information which has to stay confident. So usually it's bilateral agreements. It might be also multilateral agreements when you have more than two parties of the agreement. Okay, so starting from the beginning, you have to be cautious and aware that it's extremely important to well-define parties of such agreement. It's really crucial. And I can see it from my practice that it may cause lots of troubles if you don't do it carefully. Because the agreements bind only the parties which sign the agreements. So if you sign the agreements with one company, with one person or anyone else, you have to be aware that if that person cooperates with other people or with other entities, with other companies, those companies are not binded by this contract. So you have to well shape the agreement to make sure that the other party, the receiving party, is obliged not to give the information away to other parties, because in such case you are not protected at all. So please make sure that you know with whom you sit to the table. And what is important, you should mention in such NDAs not only the person with whom you are speaking to, but also people who are around. Like I wrote examples for you, the employees, the associates, business partners, collaborators. It's important to put an obligation on the receiving party that he will protect the information also among those people, because it protects the disclosing party. Moving on. The main part of NDA is to define what is confidential. And it's really important to know what you want to protect and how you want to do it. I put so-called laundry list of the most common items and things and information which are treated as confidential in such NDAs. So you have IPRs here, the first example, unpublished patent application. It's really extremely important for you to put it in the NDA. I know stories of inventors, of founders who had huge trouble not mentioning it in their NDAs, which they were signing. Then you may have the business information about the business model, your customers, employees. Then you may have trade secrets, financial information, strategies, plan, etc. You can put here whatever you want. The sky is the limit. However, you must make the other party sign the agreement. So you have to agree on what's going to be confidential. Then, important practical thing is to know the difference between those three periods, because they might be different. So, disclosure period. It's the period which parties of the agreements decide that information provided during that period will be treated as confidential. Of course, if they pass the test of what's defined as confidential. So we can imagine situation when you have inventors and investors who sign the NDA contract, and they decide that every information which they decided to be confidential, which is given in period of 10 days, will be treated as confidential. After that time, any piece of information you give is not confidential because of this defined disclosure period. Then you have the period of confidentiality, and it's something different. It's the obligation put on the receiving party telling for how long it has to be kept in secret. So for how long the party is obliged to keep it confidential. And then you have the duration of an agreement. And what's the most typical and recommended model is to have the period of confidentiality equal with the duration of agreement. It's the safest situation. However, you can also try to prolong the period of confidentiality after the duration of agreement. However, it's not useful for the other party. Then, usually we have in the NDA's agreement exclusions from confidentiality. So parties decide in what situations the information which they decided to be treated as confidential won't be. So you have to be really careful with those clauses, because those are the backdoors for the receiving parties. You have to be aware that if there's going to be some conflict basing on the NDA agreement, probably it will focus around that aspect. So you have to be as precise as possible to define the exclusion situation. I wrote it down, the most typical one, so the prior knowledge of the receiving party. That's the idea that the receiving party tells you that he or she knew it before you told him. The burden of proof is on the receiving party to tell you that he or she had this information before. It's typical to have such clause, but you have to bear in mind that the more precise it is, the better for you. There's another clause about subsequent knowledge from the other source than the disclosing party. It's also tough for a disclosing party, because you can imagine situation in which you share with some valuable information with the party, and later on the party tells you that someone came and told him exactly the same. What a coincidence. It happened the next day you had a meeting. You have to be careful. If it's possible, delete it from the NDA, because it's risky for you to have such clause. The third one, which I put as an example, is the information which are in public domain. So simply speaking, if you are coming with the great news which is in the newspaper, then probably you won't have protection for that. Then we have another typical clause in NDA's agreement. It's the permissible disclosure. It's the situation when both parties treat information as confidential. It passes all the requirements in the agreements. However, there are some factors which made the receiving party to disclose this information. It has to be also really well defined. Usually it's defined as the law requirement or the requirement from public administration. It might be also court order. If you imagine court proceeding, the court may oblige the party to reveal some information which are covered by your NDA. What's important to put in your NDA is the obligation to notify you. If such situation happens, if the receiving party is obliged to disclosure confidential information because the public administration made him to do it, please be sure that you will be notified about that. That the best option is to be notified before the information is disclosed. Then you can have chance to control it somehow. The worst situation is that you don't know about the disclosure. So you have to be sure that such obligation to notify is put on the receiving party. Okay, and then we have next tough practical question. How to secure the information? We are in the process of getting to know with other party. We don't have any binding agreements. How to make the other party protect your information? The most typical way is just put it simply as to make the receiving party responsible for any unauthorized disclosure or release, as I put it here. But the burden is put on you to prove that it was unauthorized, that it caused you some damage. You have to show the amount of damage, and then probably you can go and try to sue such person or persons in court. The other option is to put fine. So it works like the automat. You have the event of disclosing information, then you have the right to get fine, which is set in the agreement. As you can imagine, the receiving party is not extremely willing to agree for fixed fines for disclosing information. So you have to be aware that it won't happen in every case. You may also have the financial guarantees. It happens extremely rarely to have the fixed financial guarantees for you that the receiving party won't reveal the information. You have to think whether it's your idea, your IP is worth of putting on the table the requirement to put financial guarantee. Usually the reaction of other parties, no thank you. We don't want to speak with you if you need our bank to give you some money transferred to your account and be frozen in case that we will disclose the information. So it's nice to have it, but quite uncommon in practice. If the idea, if the information you have is really good, then probably you should convince the investors to follow you, to stick with you, and there's no risk of unauthorized leaking information. However, it may happen. You can have, which is also quite typical clause in NDAs, so-called non-compete clause. Broadly speaking, it's the idea that the parties during some fixed period won't do the things which they are discussing during their meetings, their negotiations. The last and probably least is the law and jurisdiction. It's extremely important thing, and people usually don't treat it like that when they sign several contracts. It's really important when you deal with parties who are from different countries, different jurisdiction. You have to be aware that choosing a law which will apply to your contract may give a huge advance to one of the parties of this contract. Knowing the law, having your own lawyers, having your own legal assistants is really asset in critical situation. Same with jurisdiction. You may have a jurisdiction which might be really inconvenient for you. You can imagine, for instance, the UK, where you can have huge costs of having any disputes in courts, and you have to be aware that such dispute may destroy you financially at the beginning of your startup. Okay, then moving to next step, which is a term sheet. As I told you, those subjects are put in some order. So after you sign the NDA, you may decide to start negotiating about some details of financing and cooperation. And mainly the term sheet deals with these things. So it's the document which will lead you through further negotiations and probably be a base of the further documents which you will sign with the other party. So please bear in mind that it's important document, and you have to pay attention to the clauses which are put into it. That's why I wrote few information which might be put in your term sheet. So the first category is the pre-investment clauses. Broadly speaking, it tells you what's the ad hoc situation, whether inventor has some company, whether there are other people cooperating, so-called collaborators, whether there are some financial debts, loans which were taken by the inventors. It's very important to put all this stuff into the term sheet so as both parties will know what is the starting situation. Then you have the offering terms. It's extremely important to be aware of the conditions of the investment. So you will put the money which investors will give you. You will have the time frame of of this money which will be given to you. You have to be also aware that in most situation you won't get all the money at one point. Probably it will be splitted in several cash flows, and you have to be really precise on deciding what are the conditions for the next flows. Then you have to put information how the funds will be used. Probably that will be the investors part of the term sheet. The investors will make you do with the funds what is good for the company, what is good for the startup. You cannot think that you will get money and you can go for Bahamas and buy a new car. Probably you will have to spend it for solely for the startup company. Then you can have some points or bullets telling what the strategy of such company will be, and there also probably going to be a clause telling that the inventor, the founder, has a full title to essential assets, broadly speaking, to his intellectual properties rights, which is put into the startup. Then you have another part of the term sheet, which deals with rights and restrictions. I just put it some bullets here. With the clauses which probably gonna be there, but I will discuss them later on when we will be talking about the investment agreement. So generally speaking, those are the clauses telling what happens when one of the parties wants to exit the company, how it works, what's the procedure of doing it, how the other party may stop him. What are the methods of exits? What are the methods of getting money from such company, by dividends or by other sorts? So probably you will already have such information in your term sheet. That's why it's important to be really cautious and careful while you are drafting it, while you are shaping it. You have to be aware that probably investors have their own legal assistance. They have the experience in shaping such documents. You have to try to do your best to make sure that you understand all of the provisions in the term sheet. Then you have the investment arrangements. Those are, as I mentioned before, the provisions telling what happens when the parties want to split or they want to increase share capital. I will talk about it in details discussing the investment agreements. And then you have final provisions in such document. Those are typical clauses which are put in such provisions. I just wrote down few of them. Confidentiality is what we were discussing before with the NDAs. So the broad idea is the same. Then you have the law and jurisdiction, which I mentioned before as well. What is worth telling or spending few moments is the expiry date. It is quite typical to put in your term sheet the provisions which gives parties some time to sign the term sheet. If they don't do it in the period which is defined in the term sheet, the deal is over. You have to renegotiate or you or you just simply speaking have to find someone else to cooperate with. Okay, that's how we smoothly moved to investment agreement. That's the Bible for startups. It's your main document, which is signed at the later stage of cooperation with investors. And in this document, you will have all important information, which probably will be put to the articles of association of the company which you will settle, or the company which you had before, and the articles has to be redrafted according to the provisions of investment agreement. Before we move to the specific clauses, the main idea is that investment agreement gives you a high degree of flexibility. You can shape it in the way you like it. But on the other hand, you will be responsible for the things that you put into your investment agreement, which you signed. So you have to be aware that it gives you whole possibilities to draft your cooperation, but you have to be really careful, because later on you will be held responsible for the things that you sign in the investment agreement. Broadly speaking, Polish law does not have any fixed typical model of investment agreements. It's really useful because each startup has to be dealt solely. Every situation is different, and the more your legal documents are shaped to your specific circumstances, the better. So you use the freedom of contracts to do it. But there is a question. Is there equality of arms? If the both parties of the investment agreement has the same rights, probably they do at the beginning, do they have the same sources? Probably not. If you are dealing with professional investors, you're dealing with someone who is specialized in having such deals. And on the other hand, sometimes you are alone, sometimes you have help of your friend, sometimes you have help of some lawyer who's with you. I strongly suggest you to use the help of experience, and that would be good to use, simply speaking, legal assistant from the very beginning, and for sure at the point of drafting investment agreements, because there are no such thing like equality of arms in this situation. You have to be aware of that. That's the you know, philosophical idea which doesn't come out in reality. Okay, so because the investment agreements, as I told you, differs a lot among them, and there is no one fixed model for them, I will just tell you something about the core provisions which probably might be found in some investment agreements. So generally you have the investment provisions, which tells you what happens with money and when the money comes to the company, when the money comes to the founder. And it might be shaped in different ways, in different manners. So each time you have to be cautious and read your draft of investment agreements as many times as you can. You have investment arrangements, which I will discuss. Now I told you about the methods of exiting, the ways how the shares might be sold, and there are certain techniques to do it. The idea is that both parties meet to make a deal, to make the idea working. So the investors want to have the founders on board as long as possible, because they are the ones who has the idea and who convinced them that the idea might be put into the reality. Nevertheless, probably you will have in your, for sure you will have in your investment agreement provisions telling how the shares might be sold, simply speaking. Who can do it, when it can be done, and how it could be done. Please pay attention to those provisions. Those are extremely important for you on the side of inventors. So you would be very lucky if you had IPO. That's the idea. That's the place where the road with startups leads. Maciek is smiling. I wish you all to have it. I just put it, let's say, in quotation, the clause which will tell you what the IPO is. So probably it's going to be defined this way or similar, and that it's sale offer of any shares in the share capital of the company to the public pursuant to public offering under an applicable law. Probably if it's going to be in Poland, there are certain provisions dealing with public offer. Speaking not as a lawyer, but as a lay person, simply it's putting your company into the stock exchange, to switch your company into so-called public company and listing your shares on the stock exchange. I wish you that it's going to be the end of your adventure with startup. However, sometimes it may finish in a different way, which are not worse than that. Those are just simply different. So one of the methods of selling the shares, one of the strategy, is so-called drag along. So that's the idea that you have the privileged shareholder. It might be the majority shareholder. However, it doesn't have to be the majority shareholder. Probably it's going to be investor in this situation. So when such party sells his shares, if there is a drag along condition, the minority shareholders are obliged to join this transaction, and they are obliged to sell the shares on the same conditions as the privileged party. In practice, it doesn't have to mean that you are obliged to sell all of your shares. It might be the proportion of your shares. So you can imagine a situation when you have the investor who is selling half of his shares, and the other shareholders are made to sell half of their shares as well to the certain buyer. That's the idea of keeping the shares in one hand and keeping the certain value of the shares. Because you can imagine a situation when the especially at the first stages of the startup life, one of the party starts selling his shares and it's not controlled by the other one. It might completely dilute the shareholders, the other one. And as I told you before, the main idea is to stick with the same people, especially at the beginning. So that's the drag along clause. Usually it protects investors, and usually you will have it in your investment agreement. You have to live with that. That's one of the conditions of giving you money for some business. You have to be aware that investors, of course, love the creative people. They love to change our reality, but they also want to earn money, simply speaking, and they have to have some means of securing this aim. Nevertheless, you still are entitled to put some limitations to such clauses. For instance, you may put in the investment agreement the time limit, telling that none of the party may sell his shares or may oblige the other party to sell their shares during a period of 1 year, of 2 years, of 3 years. It protects you. It makes sure that you will have your shares for this fixed time. So please be aware of this clauses, of this provisions. Those are really important for you. You can also define the amount of shares which could be sold in drag along procedure, and it's also useful to limit the shares. As I told you, you can limit it to the certain amount proportion of the shares you have, and then you have tag along, which is quite similar. It's simply the opposite idea of drag along. So if there is a situation that some shareholder sells his shares and it's the majority shareholder, then the minority shareholder have the right. That's important. That's the difference between drag along. Here you have the right. There you have the obligation. So the minority shareholder have the right to join this transaction and to sell his shares on the same conditions as the majority shareholder. This idea protects minority shareholder not to to be left on the boat which is sinking. If the majority shareholder found someone who's willing to buy some shares, then you can stick to this transaction. You can get some money from selling your proportion of shares. And it's the same limitations deals with tag-along clause as with drag-along clause. You can also have time limitation. You can also have the fixed amount of shares which gonna be sold in procedure of tag along. So here you can see that that degree of flexibility which is given to you. So at the beginning it sounds horrible that you might be made to sell your child, which you were comforting, which you were loving with all your human power. Yes, it's true. You might be made to do it with drag along, but you may try to limit it. you may try to put the provisions which will protect you, which will give you chance to control the situation, at least in some aspects. Then we have the liquidation preferences. Probably those gonna be clauses which are in most of the investment agreements. Simply speaking, those are the conditions of paying off the shareholders. Usually it deals with the money that were given by the investors. So the investors puts some provisions, puts some clauses in case of liquidation, so as they can get as much money as at least which they invested. If there is some left proportions of money, it's going to be divided in the way it's put it in the liquidation provisions. It may sound horrible, but you have the opportunity to draft it in a way which is going to be more friendly to you. You can put some time limits, you can put the fixed amount of money, you can put the condition. The sky is the limit, simply speaking, as I told you before. It's the only matter of convincing the other party that the idea is important for you and you really need it, and then you can do something which is which will protect you in case of liquidation. Okay, I won't tell more about liquidation. If you have any questions, please do ask me. Then we have the lockup. As I wrote, simply it's the obligation not to exit the company, not to sell the shares. As I told you, usually it applies to founders. The investors want to have on board founders as long as it's possible. On the one hand, it may block you, but on the other hand, you might be sure that you won't be get rid of at some early stage of the startup company. However, lockup may works for both parties of the investment agreement. So you can shape it in a way that the investor also will be obliged not to exit the company till some certain moment, which might be decided as a fixed date or which may be decided as a moment of getting some another funds, of increasing your share capital. It may be shaped in many, many different ways. Then you have what's important in lockup: the time period. You have to be careful with that, and you have to imagine what will happen in future and try to predict the future. It's not easy, but you have to do it when you have the lockup clause. As you can see, you have to be really careful with investment agreement. You have to be really careful with term sheet. The Romans said, there's a proverb that volenti non fit in uria. Yeah, I would say that vigilantibus non fit in uria, meaning that if you are careful, nothing won't hurt you. You have the chance to decide on important matters dealing with your startup. Now's the time for questions from the audience. I'm here for you, so please don't hesitate to ask me. Annie.
I have one on NDA. From your experience, do you see that more people or investors or partners write the fine as the amount, or they rather write it as if they break the law, they have to, you know,
like a percentage of the value.
At the early stage, it's difficult to put it as a percentage of value, because probably you won't know the value of the information which is revealed. So I don't remember any NDA in our law firm which was set in that way. It's tempting to put a fixed fine when the other party unauthorized leaks the information. However, I would say it's more common to have the broad provision of legal responsibility for doing it, which is more difficult for the disclosing party to deal with at the later stage. But of course, when you prepare such documents, when you are before signing it, you have to think of the worst scenario. Always you have to do it. But you have to at the same time know that the worst scenarios do not happen all the time. So if you sit to the table with some well-known investors, probably you may be a bit more relaxed than with the individual investors or the people who you don't know, who you cannot gather information about. So that's the answer.
Some kind of term sheets and maybe NDAs and terms of use. So the question is it okay to use some kind of templates? Maybe modify them a little bit for our needs, but to start with something.
That's the only option for you, I would say. Yeah, sure, sure. So colleague asked whether it's possible to use templates of the documents I were speaking about in case when there are no lawyers on a board who may help. So, as I told, probably it's the only option. But please do your best to find someone who may help you, with whom you may consult such documents. It doesn't necessarily has to be a lawyer from international law company. Sometimes it might be a person who simply has some experience, who did it before, and who may tell you that there are risky provisions. Honestly speaking, as a person who deal with it on a daily basis, the templates which are available, you know, of course that's the starting point. But please treat it as a starting point. Sure. Maybe I will pass you the microphone.
Okay. Thank you. I'm referring to my colleague's question about the templates of the documents. Well, it says that you are at the start and inexperienced. Well, the investment agreement and the term sheet can determine your whole future. You can make mistakes there. You can lose all your the work of your life sometimes. So it's really important to be really careful. And therefore, I would like to ask you if you can give some most common tricks for the like the investors are, you know, using to make harm of inexperience, because startup people are usually inexperienced, so they have the something extra, something special, and they are devoted, but they do not have the money. And it often happens in real life that they are getting used by this tricky investors, or it's a brutal real life. So I think it will be useful to hear some examples for the people to know, for example, if they're using templates, to know what to be, where to be careful, what to look out for. Thank you.
Mateusz, just before you answer, because not yet yesterday, not all of us had the chance to have beer together, so maybe it's a good idea, Paweł, to introduce yourself, which project you represent, and we want also to know each other.
Okay, so my name is Paweł Peter, I'm here together with Justyna. We have a start text startup LGM, and we are developing product that take off limits from electricity generators, so we can get more power from any electricity generator, or make it a few times smaller to give the same amount of power. And we have already a bit experience. We already got through the term sheet and the investment agreement phase, so we already have established a company, as a GenStop company. But yes, we want to accelerate. We want to get experience, because we have just recently started. We went only through a few steps. So we can share our experience. You're welcome to ask any questions. If you know them, you can answer or discuss. Thank you.
Thank you, Pavel, for your question. Thank you for your declaration, which you made at the beginning of your speech. I'm happy that it wasn't greedy lawyer who told that it's important to sometimes spend some sources, some time, money on preparation of the documents I was telling you. Just as an anecdote, the case which I spent night on, that's the example of the company which nowadays is quite huge one, but at the beginning they were small and they did not protect their intellectual rights in a proper way, and nowadays they are sued by the huge German competitor, and they are facing the option of closing up their business. That might be a rough example for you, but it shows that mistakes sometimes might cost you a lot, even after a long time. The process of getting finance for your project is one of the examples. The company which I'm talking about had different problem with the trademark. They did not want to check whether the trademark they are registering is already protected somehow. They did some research, but on their own. And now they have a huge problem. We have the proceeding in the Alicante, in the European Office of Intellectual Property. We have proceeding in Polish court, and the situation is not really good, and they are not so happy. And nowadays they are spending much more money on solving this problem than the money they would invest at the beginning. I must tell you that on the market you have, in my opinion, lots of people who may help you. I might be as well sitting on the other side of the audience. 2-3 years ago I settled the law firm on my own with my partner, and we decided to deal with startups. And 3 years ago it was like terra incognita. Completely. It was like, you know, going to Mars. Nowadays, most of the law companies says we are professional in startups. Yes, sure, we do it. So you can get better or worse help, but still, every suggestion might be useful for you. You told me about tricks. These are the tricks, as I told you. But you are there is a light in the tunnel. You can limit it. There are many tricks that might be used. I put it the most common one, liquidation provisions. Those are extremely sensitive because at the end of the day it may come out that company which has money is sold and you as inventor won't have a penny from it. It may happen, but it's not always the option. You may try to fight with it. That's why the help might be needed. There's a question. Yeah.
So you mentioned that
Bitcoin
is important that the final provisions of the time sheet we should include some laws and jurisdictions that would provide, let's say, additional security for the deal. And my question is if there's any particular jurisdiction or legislation that you'd recommend for startups to refer to.
And what's your name?
Sam.
What do you do?
I'm from
Neo-Ecology,
so I'm a technological
startup.
Welcome, everyone.
We are very happy to meet you.
Thank you for the question. That's a very good question. And the matter of deciding what law and jurisdiction will apply deals with all of these documents. I just discuss it with the term sheet, but it's even more important with an investment agreement. Same with NDA. It works there as well. Question of best law applicable. As a patriot, I would say it's Polish law. It's always. Maybe not always, but in case that you are British, if you are not, it's always good to have your own law, because better or worse, you know this law. You can easily get help when you have some legal matter to be solved. When you have a different law, it might be extremely difficult to get legal assistance. You may pay for a legal assistant twice, three times more than you would pay for a lawyer with your law. But sometimes you are dealing with situation when you have both sides from different countries. My observation is that investors will force you to choose the law and jurisdiction applicable or better for them. But still, I would say that you have to fight. You cannot just, you know, say, okay, fine. I would check whether it may cause troubles in future. Because if everything is smooth, then perfect. No problems. Troubles come when you have some problems. And then you have to stick to the law, and you realize that you have the American law.
Yeah, a place of jurisdiction in US.
Yeah, exactly. And then you start to think whether in the US they have same law or maybe different states has different law. And maybe in California it's nice place, sunny one, but not the best for being sued. Yeah, you have to be careful with that. I might say that for the deals which go through my law office, we are dealing with many clients from Central Eastern Europe. We are having clients from the Western countries, from France, from the UK, from Germany, from Spain. For our comfort, we suggest them Polish law and jurisdiction of Polish courts, especially if there is any connection with Poland in such deal, especially if the company will operate in Poland. It's the most convenient option. That's what I might suggest you if you are thinking of doing any business in Poland.
Okay, so I'm Mike, together with Leszek, we are pending time of Pro, and we are doing some natural processing there. Okay, so I have a question about Jagiellon clause. And is there a way in Polish law to protect us from using this clause and the investor who have some other companies, other organization, they are connected to him, to dissolve our shares by using this clause? Is there a way to protect other than time or amount of shares? So he's selling the shares to other company who belongs to him or is connected somewhere to his company, to his shares. Is there a protect?
Thank you for the question. I showed you the easiest way to get protection. So time, amount of shares, those are the simplest way. But the sky is the limit. There are no certain provisions in Polish law which will define the procedure of drag along, which means that you can do whatever you want. Whatever you will make the other party of the contract to sign it. You can block the investor by lockup. You can try to put the provision in your contract that it won't be at any time possible to be sold to the entities which are somehow connected with the investor. There are many ways to bypass such drag along provision. It depends on certain circumstances and situation you have. There is always possibility. You just have to convince the other party for it. You have to convince the other party that it's crucial for you to have it.
I can say, if I may, of course, I would like to add that it happens very rarely that an investor on a startup stage would like to deal with the founder, who is especially a technical person. Sometimes it happens when the founder is, for example, good in marketing or teaching, but for engineers it happens exceptionally rarely because you are the all soil of the startup. Actually, around you, they are rather putting some clauses to prevent you leaving the project. And these are very tough clauses, that you are not able to leave your project, but not in opposite way. But if I have the voice, I also, and apart from playing with camera, which I like to do, it's super cool, I have to. I want also to ask one question. Lots of the startups ask me if we can avoid NDA on the first step and put it directly into term sheet. And we agree. I want to disclose that we agree very often. They say, yeah, it's just faster because we use lawyer expertise only once, and we have everything inside. So basically you take two documents and put them titled term sheet. And there is a huge clause called no disclosure clauses. Is it good, or it's like you wouldn't recommend that?
Thank you, Maciek, for your question.
At your service, sir.
You didn't introduce yourself, but you're a well-known person, so you don't have to do it.
Celebrity.
Yeah, celebrity. And you're the cameraman, so you're the one who leads here. Of course, you can do it in a way you are telling startups. Of course, it's possible not to have NDA as a first document signed by the parties, but the risk is put on the startup. If you are well known and legitimate investor like Startup Hub Poland, then probably the startup coming to you know that you won't do nasty thing at the beginning, and you may start to talk without having protection by the means of NDA. It happens quite often, in fact, that the NDA clause is put into the term sheet. It's the question of how much information you want to reveal at this stage when you are not bound by such non-disclosure clause. Doesn't matter if it's in separate documents or in other document like term sheets. It's possible, of course.
Thanks.
Okay, guys, any other questions? Observations?
Who from the very beginning didn't know what is NDA? Because you haven't said on what is behind the shortcuts.
Yes, I did.
Is there anybody? It's like not you, I will not put the finger like shame on you. I also learned one day.
Shame.
What is that?
Maciek, shame on you. Look at this.
No, we had this on the beginning. Oh, sorry. Like NDA, NDP, everything is clear for you. I've met brilliant, outstanding engineers and professors from different branches that have no idea about our vocabulary.
Yeah, true. We are operating IPR, with acronyms, all the time. IPR, what the hell is it? That's the idea you're coming with, putting on the table. But it's quite easy to get friendly with those nasty shortcuts.
I have also a question regarding NDA. Is it common to protect your general idea? Because I assume that NDA, in most cases, is protecting your operational information, but how you are going to do it, not exactly what you are going to do, but how. Is it bounding, if it can protect the idea itself?
That's good and tough question at the same time. It's not so easy to protect the information which is purely the idea. That's why it's important and well practiced to describe it. There is a risk of leaking information. The more detailed you are, the bigger the risk is. But if you're at the stage in which you know how you will develop your idea, then you may describe it. The ways you want to put your idea into practice, the technical idea, the process of doing it. Then it's much easier for you to prove if someone else is using the very way or the very process you described that it came from the receiving party.
Does it should be in the NDA description that
contain some part of the how I'm going to do it, or only the idea. It's difficult because when we are showing the idea, then we are almost already disclosing the idea.
Exactly. There is a precise moment in time when the NDA is still a draft. It's not a signed document, and you have to put something into it. So you have to balance it. You have to balance what you want to show at this precise moment. That's why it's very common way of doing it by describing it without giving too many details. Like telling what you want to do, it's, I don't know, for instance, biotechnology, you describe the idea and you describe that the confidentiality will cover the information of processing it at the later stages without describing it precisely, but telling that those stages will contain of, I don't know, 4 steps, for instance. That's what I can recommend you.
I think I can use my voice.
Sure.
Without a microphone. So we're together here with Anna from Hosotech, which is a company focused on producing antibacterial additive to different types of materials. And I have a question regarding the term sheet. I'm not sure whether you already talked about it. I missed a bit of your presentation. I'm sorry for that, but I had a call, which I need to pick up. I was wondering, in your practice, the term sheet is usually binding or non-binding. I've seen a lot of term sheets that are non-binding because they're very general, but very often the investors want to have a binding term sheet. So just, if we can say something about it, or if you already covered that topic. I'm sorry if I'm repeating this, but I just wanted to hear.
That's the perfect question, because I did not say a word on that, which is my mistake. Of course, you can have two options, binding and non-binding, and it's difficult for me to give you percentage. How many of the term sheets are binding and how many are not. It really depends on situation, because if you want to do it in a way that Maciek told us, that you don't want to have the NDA before you sign the term sheet, then you probably will have binding term sheet since you have the non-disclosure clause. You may try to define which provisions are binding for parties, not whole document, but some parts of it, which are crucial for parties. And it's not only for the investors, it works for founders as well. Because when you grab some investor, you want to have him. You want to start the project. You want to oblige him to start financing your project. You want to settle some certain timetable to have the investment agreement signed. So you can have two options.
My only concern would be that if the term sheet is binding, and generally the term sheet does not contain all the crucial elements of the final investment agreement, then we need to rely on the intention of the parties, and then it's very often based on something that is not written anywhere. So then one person or one party might say, oh, we intended this, this was this and this, and the other party sort of say something different. So what I often see is that the term sheet, the elements of the investment agreement are non-binding, and the non-disclosure, exclusivity are usually binding, because this is very essential for the startup or the founders. But I've seen one term sheet or two, three term sheets when the investor insisted on having it binding. And that's why I wonder how often it happens. Because, you know, maybe it's very often that, you know, the parties did not foresee what may happen in the future. There are going to be differences in their opinions.
Yeah, you have two options, and you may mix the options, as you told, that you may have the binding parts and non-binding parts. What I try to do in my legal practice with startups, I try to be as precise as possible, and I insist on putting intentions of parties into the term sheet, of telling what they want to achieve at the end of the day. And it may help in the situation you mentioned. It's for your own safety. Any other questions? If not, please be more than warm and welcome invited for some meeting with me on next Friday. You can ask me questions which need the NDA to be signed. You can ask me all the questions if I will have troubles with answering them instantly. I will do it via other means of communication. If it's possible, please jot me down a short email that you would like to meet with me, if it's possible, just to tell what we are gonna talk about. It might be easier for you and for me to get certain information. It was a pleasure for me to be here and to have the interesting discussion with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.